foremost is the election of officers. We do need a chair, we do need a vice chair, so that, we can't do that without a quorum. Public hearing that we're going to be bringing to you this afternoon. Being that we haven't been able to establish the building advisory board meeting officially, we can now establish officially the public public appeal and public hearing. For today, to give you a synopsis of how this works and the process thereof, first there's to conduct this public hearing, there's a presentation by the staff. There will then be comments by the applicant, which is present. There will then be public comment if anyone wants to speak in public to this appeal. There'll be time for a rebuttal after that, and then discussion and action from the appeal panel, from the BAB appeal panel. By majority vote, you're going to vote one way or the other, whether to deny or accept it, this appeal, and you will need to publicly state your findings of fact as to why.
Do you all know how important it is?
Yeah.
Please, Randy, we have a full fund to
make. We record that.
Yeah?
Now we have a quorum.
Let's do this then.
Well, let's move back. let's take care of, or let's go ahead and open up our building advisory board meeting officially.
Okay, we're going to open up the board advisory board today, September 8th, 2015. Any public comments, questions from the public related to topics that are not part of the meeting agenda, but are relative and to the authority of responsibility of the board advisory board at this time. Not seeing any. Next on the agenda is approval of the minutes.
Shouldn't be too difficult on this one. It was only this much.
I move that we approve the minutes.
Okay.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion passed. Okay, next on the agenda is election of officers, chairman and vice chair. Do we have a motion? I guess. Are any recommendations?
Be a recommendation to start with. Who you want to recommend?
Chairman needs me to be the chairman.
There we go. And for vice chair?
Mr. Miller.
And then you'll need to vote on that to make it official. Assuming that Mr. Bixby and Mr. Miller will accept said nominations.
If I need some help. Yeah. Why, that's not.
Well, depend on the staff. I mean, the. Depending on you to help us immensely.
We'll do.
Nominations.
Right. Okay, we have a first and second. We have a vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Okay, motion carries.
You weren't voting.
I abstained.
Very good. We have an official quorum, and we can take care of all of our business today. As we move on to item D, this public hearing, and through the process thereof on the presentation by the staff, the comments by the applicant is the second thing, public comment, a rebuttal and discussion and action after that. To begin to introduce this to you, make the computer behave. The reason we're here today is on August 15th, 2015, a violation notice was issued to Ms. Baker by Mr. Peterman, our property maintenance officer, regarding the modification to an existing 6-foot privacy fence, and it in essence increased that height to 8 feet. Our property maintenance code and the International Residential Code has amended the zoning regulations as enforced by the City of Salina. Specifically, we're looking at section 42-79-2. They contain the requirements for the maintenance and construction for accessory uses on property to include fences. And on chapter 31, PMC chapter 42-79 and PMC chapter 8-35, it states as follows. All accessory structures, including detached garages, fences, and walls, shall be maintained structurally sound and good working order. In this particular case, it is, appears to be structurally sound. On section 42-79, which is our zoning regulations, accessory uses permitted by Article 4 of this chapter, recreational laundry drying equipment and open space and enclosed fences not exceeding 6 feet in height. So we have a restriction on the height of fences, both in zoning and both in building codes. R105.2, work exempt from permit, would be the International Residential Code requirement for this. And again, it states, as I see in item 2, fences not over 6 feet in height. So not only do we have zoning regulations in place, we have our building code regulations in place, we have the Salina Municipal Code as amended and enforced. None of those entities allow a fence over 6 feet high. The appeal application, as we received it, indicates that this is being appealed because of a rescue dog, a rescue animal, that she recently adopted, and that this dog will jump the 6-foot fence. And that's the nature of this appeal. And I'm sure Mrs. Baker will share more or speak more to that end as we progress on. We've issued a violation notice on 7/22/15. The application for appeal was submitted by Ms. Baker on 8/18/15, and we had a follow-up site visit today showing it's still the existing conditions, and we'll pull those photos up for you. There's a correction notice that was issued. That the picture is laying down. I think we can fix that too. It won't let me do it in tools.
How about view?
There we go.
There.
Much better. What, and it's a little difficult to see on the rear, but there's a lattice type wood fence that's been added to the top of this 6-foot once wood fence. The front that you see there appears to be a 6-foot chain link, which is open. And the lattice, let's go to the next picture. If you look at the top here, you see the lattice. Mm-hmm. Here where the laser pointer is, that's the 2-foot lattice. It's going all the way down the length of the rear and the side of the fence. Probably looks a little more clear in your packet, and that is the nature of the appeal that we have today. The Building Advisory Board, the appeal panel, what your action will be today is either going to be one, if the appeal panel determines that the true intent or the code or rules that are legally adopted by the city of has been incorrectly interpreted, or if the provisions of the applicable code do not fully apply, or that the code official has incorrectly denied a request for a modification, you can make a motion at that point to grant the appeal. If, however, you feel that the rules and regulations have been correctly interpreted and they do fully apply, and that the code official has not incorrectly made a determination for those code requirements and regulations, well then it would be the appeals panel would rule to deny at that point. So our next portion now is for the applicant to come up and speak with you and give you her thoughts or answer any questions that you may have of her, and in turn, if you have any questions of me or any, need any further advice or answer any concerns that you have, I'm happy to do that as well. Okay. Ms. Baker.
Hi. Like you said, I adopted a dog, and he is big, and he could jump the 6-foot fence. We tried to put it at a lean. He just pulled it down. We tried a kennel. He mangled it. And this is the only thing that has kept him in the yard. That's about it.
He doesn't climb chain link fence.
No. He tried once and he got his foot stuck in there and he never touched it again. That's why the front is shorter, because it's chain link.
I went by and looked at, you know, drove by and looked mm-hmm. at the location and the fence and so forth. I think you did a good job. It's not, like I say, I think it's solid mm-hmm. and you didn't do a bad job on it, but yeah. I don't think that's the problem. I think the problem is just the code and the height.
I have no other way to keep him in the yard. That's just, I'm hoping he'll kind of grow out of it. He's only like a year and a half old, and he just got doo-doo, so we've kind of, so I'm hoping he'll calm down a little.
Do I understand that she can go through an appeal process to the zoning to get permission to have an 8-foot fence? But it's not impossible to have an 8-foot fence in the city of Salina, right? I mean, you could go through a process and make that happen.
There's a process, Board of Zoning Appeals. Any increase in height would require application to and approval of the Board of Zoning Appeals, but they will be...
And that would have to be prior to it being built?
Correct.
I didn't know that.
Now that the fence is up, the fence is in violation. Nothing in our regulations allow anything over 6 feet. So that we need to address today.
That's just without a permit, correct?
But...
You can have a fence over 8 feet as long as you have a permit to put it up?
You have to go to the Board of Zoning Appeals.
It's no higher than 6 foot.
There's just no permit for a fence.
If this application had went to the Board of Zoning Appeals first, and the Board of Zoning Appeals approved 8-foot fence as it's designed today, and they'll approve materials and that type of thing as well, if they approved it the way it looks today, well, then the next step, you would have to get a building permit for anything over 6 feet. And that's where we are. So now that it's up, it didn't go through the Board of Zoning Appeals process. It's up and it's in violation, so we are making a ruling today on the violation. Is anything that we've done misinterpret the regulations that we have in place, or would anything, the code officials' opinions, the code officials' actions, anything there that would allow this to occur? And that's what we're looking at today. The next step would be a application to the Board of Zoning Appeals, but there again, it's in violation today without permission from them, so.
Okay, is there any way that we could give her an extension on before action is taken and give her time to go to the zoning? I mean, I hate the idea of tearing this thing down and then rebuilding it after she goes through the zoning appeals. With the idea that she will move as quickly as she can, and I'm sure that's not very quick going through a zoning board, but and then when that decision is made, the fence either stays up or comes down. Can that happen?
Probably the only problem is going to be is if she does appeal and the zoning says, okay, you can have an 8-foot fence, but it's going to have to be designed different. So the fence might have to come down and go back up.
But that's going to be the ruling of the Board of Zoning Appeals.
Right.
They're going to look at compatibility. They're going to look at design. They're going to look at more factors than we would other than does the code allow it, does the code not allow it? We don't have any regulation that allows it over 6 feet.
Right. But can she have the time to appeal it?
That is staff. We'll have to check and see when the next...
Right, before it would have to come down.
Or how long it will be, how far out it would be for her to be able to get on the Board of Zoning Appeals agenda.
Yeah, the issue you have before you today, and only today, not in the future, not in the past, but the issue you have before you today is, did this city code inspector make the wrong decision? And we should allow the 6-foot fence?
Well, yeah, by code, she's in violation.
Correct.
Okay, so we decide, and by code, she is in violation. If we do that, then what are you going to do? Make her tear the fence down? Or give her time to appeal? I mean, it's back in your court then, right?
Right.
Yes.
We more than likely would work on a compliance agreement, a timeline for her to come within compliance of making that fence compliant with the city codes.
Which would mean she could appeal and get the permission or tear it down.
I believe you're correct.
I like that
approach.
But the compliance agreement, the only thing the compliance agreement can do at this point is establish an appeal hearing with the Board of Zoning Appeal.
An ending date.
And an application, so it'll have to be a start date and an end date for some kind
of
resolution.
We're not voting on that. We're just voting on the others. But
we're only voting is it whether she's in violation or right. She's not,
right,
according to the code and Salina.
Correct. And did we make any error in our enforcement of that?
Well, I don't have any problem with what you presented here, that she's in violation.
Right.
But I just told we can get this.
I'm sure, say tomorrow or the next few days, she's going to go and do what you recommend for her to do before she has to tear it down. I mean, if she does that, I think you'll work with her. But if she goes and doesn't show up for 2-3 weeks, it's a whole different story.
It's not gonna happen, I wanna keep my dog.
Right, but I mean, that's what we're look, we're all looking, I think, the same situation, but we can't guarantee you that they're gonna approve it, but we're just looking at where you're at right now.
We could take it to the next step, basically, what we're doing.
Right, right.
And by doing that, it would be a compliance agreement, and that's something that you could come in tomorrow, whatever, and sit down with us, and we could work with you on that.
Right. So I think we're all in understanding yet, so.
But you still have to make a ruling today.
I have a runner too, so I can.
He doesn't run, he just jumps. He jumps and he'll sit on the outside of the fence.
And won't jump back.
And he, yeah. And then he learned how to open my other gate that I had, and all my dogs went to doggy jail.
So what we really need to do is vote to deny.
Right, that's all we can.
Yeah. And I move that we vote to deny and.
Second.
He need to involve the public in this process. We may have somebody from there who's gonna want to speak.
Ask for any public comment.
Sorry.
Any other questions for the applicant? Okay, thank you.
That it?
Is there anybody else in the audience that would like to say anything? I guess it's the next. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Well, then it comes back to the board for your decision, it really now.
Bring it back to the board to vote now.
So I move that we vote to deny.
Second.
We've got a first and second to deny the application, and all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay. Then next few days, just go down and.
Okay.
See what you have to do with that.
I can do that.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, next on the agenda is Uniform Mechanical Code Subcommittee Final Report, Discussion Recommendations for Approval and Approval.
All right. Thank you, Chair, members of the board. In keeping with our board's directive to continue with moving forward with these code adoption process, we're now presenting to you this evening the final draft of the 2012 Uniform Mechanical Code with Salina Municipal Code Amendments. Staff, again, we express a sincere thank you to the members of the subcommittees for the time, discussions, our diligent work behind this, and it resulted in this final draft. And we will be requesting a decision from a board this evening to move forward with this final draft as part of the code adoption process and packet, which we will be presenting to the City Commission at a later date for approval. Your two identified options will be, one, to approve a motion to direct staff to move forward with the code adoption process to include the 2012 Uniform Mechanical Code and the Salina Municipal Code Amendments, or approve a motion to direct staff to provide specified additional information or take specified additional action before making a decision, or other action as the board deems appropriate. I'm not sure, the packets went out about a week ago, I'm not sure how much of this as you've went through and read through. A lot of this, and I'll go through it quickly and briefly, we're reflecting the 2012 edition of the Uniform Mechanical Code. So the items that you see that are deleted, altered, modified, or red text is through conversations and many meetings with the subcommittee and our decision on what is best for the City of Salina for this code to work best for us and our community. Whenever you see the word delete, it's either administrative section or it's repetition in the Uniform Mechanical Code. Anything that is administrative stays in place. A lot of the amendments here we kept as was written because they serve us well and continue to serve us well, and the code language was not enough to change or alter these. This is the one I want to bring up. We'll focus on for a few minutes. We spent quite a bit of time on this, and reason being that myself and representatives from IAPMO, Mr. Shepherd, we were unable to find this table. There is no table 12-42 in any code body that I could find. And it had been in the amendment and been in the Salina Municipal Code for many years. So it took us quite some time to reference and find out where did this come from? What was it referring to? The best solution, and I know it's a table from the NFPA standard, NFPA 54, which is the standard for National Fuel Gas Code is what it is, but they don't have a 12-42 either. However, the table is the same. In NFPA 54, in this document, and in the, believe it or not, 2012 Uniform Plumbing Code, they put this table in there as well. Now, representatives from HAPMO and myself and others, we're not quite sure why, but that's what the code body did. Interesting enough, the 2015 edition of the Uniform Mechanical Code, the Uniform Plumbing Code, totally does away with this table. It's not included any longer. They reference specifically NFPA 54, and that's where this reference is coming from anyway. Again, we deleted sections that were repetition. So with that being said, with what was presented to you, we would like a decision from the board as to move forward with the Uniform Mechanical Code as was presented, or if the board decides or wants to put any modifications or changes to that for us to take it to the City Commission at a later date.
Any questions to the staff? It's pretty self-explanatory, basically.
Yeah, I move that we move forward. Second.
Okay, we've got first and second to move forward on the mechanical. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion passed. Okay. Moving forward, next on the agenda.
Next on the agenda, agenda item F. It's going to be similar to what we just did, but this is the plumbing code as opposed to the Uniform Mechanical Code. And again, we would appreciate a decision from the board to move forward with this final draft as part of this code adoption process and packet that will be submitted to the City Commission at a later date. Again, we are reflecting the Uniform Plumbing Code 2012 edition and the amendments that best serve the city and community of Salina and give us the best code as possible. Again, when you look at anything that's preference with a 101, 103, 104, 102, those are usually administrative and they set up administrative duties for the code. So you always see in any municipal code, in any municipality, there'll be an amendment that's going to cover these items that specific to that jurisdiction. We did want to expand on this one, and we did put in where we are exempt from work and to clarify what's exempt from work. Where we didn't have previous text that was very clear on that, we now put these items in so there's no misinterpretation as to what is exempt from a permit. And it also mirrors the language that we found in other code bodies that we've discussed in previous meetings. Again, when we see delete, it is no longer necessary. See, the repetition or the code language as written in the 2012 edition best serves the city and the needs of Salina. We previously didn't have any language or specifics as to the freezing protection. We wanted this to parallel with our other code bodies too, as we've discussed in International Residential Code, International Building Code. Our frost depth is 36 inches. We wanted to make sure this was reflected in this uniform code as well, so everyone's aware that it needs to be, the water lines need to be 6 inches below the frost depth when they're installed. probably the biggest item that we've, and it took several meetings and a lot of discussion for us to come up with this table. Previously, the city of Salina used 2904, table in the international, 2006 International Building Code for their plumbing fixture count. That will not, no longer be the case once this is, goes through the city commission and is approved as our code body. We are going to the table 422.1 specific to the Uniform Plumbing Code, and that will be the table we will be using. Much discussion went into this. It was consensus of the subcommittee that we use this table, and we went through every single item in this table to create this table. A lot of work. Much appreciation to the subcommittee for the hard work as well. And this will be the table for your plumbing fixture count once adopted by the city commission. If you want to take this, if you want to read through it, or if there's something that's standing out that you want me to discuss, but I think we did an incredible job on this. It simplified it from the previous table, and it will, in essence, will be, there will be more plumbing fixtures required by using this table as it was previously. Part of that reason is what is called Gender Parity Act that has been in legislation in Washington, D.C. since 2011, 2013, 2014. And it's not a new concept. Some people refer to it as the Potty Parity Law, Party Parity Act. It's a fact that if you go to any sporting event, if you go to any venue, you're going to see females that are going to stand in line waiting for a restroom. It takes longer for them to do what they need to do. And this law is trying to address that. Especially sporting events or something of heavy use. So once this is adopted, we will indeed be increasing our plumbing fixture count. Is it going to increase for, say, apartment dwellings, apartment complexes, single family dwellings, one and two family dwellings? Absolutely not. The table stays the same as it was. It's only when you have a large group, we're building a stadium, we're building large auditoriums, large theaters, those type of venues, where you'll see the increase more so than any other item. And I don't want to read through the whole table, but there was several hours spent on this table, we will suffice it to say. We also wanted to put a note here at the bottom. This is truly the Uniform Plumbing Code. This is the Uniform Plumbing Code table. We enforce the Uniform Plumbing Code in the city of Salina. As such, we should be enforcing the table from the Uniform Plumbing Code as modified here, or as amended. The one caveat we needed to address, though, and is even specified in the Uniform Plumbing Code, how do you determine the occupant load? What is the occupant load? This is based on occupancy. Do you have over 400 people? Do you have 100 people? Do you have 85 people? Where do those numbers come from? That is coming from Section 1004 of the International Building Code and the International Fire Code. They both say the same thing, and that's how we determine occupant load. Then once we know the occupant load, we can go to this table and determine how many plumbing fixtures we need for that particular occupancy. And here, we are enforcing the plumbing code as written. We no longer will be having these amendments. A lot of them, if you look at the blending of the red and black text that I provided to you in that table, if you read that in its entirety, that's exactly what the code says. So we're basically made a quick determination that the code already says that. Why do we have this amendment? It's not an amendment, it's repetition. So you'll find that over and over and over, where only just a few words are different. Again, it took much more time on the plumbing code than it did the mechanical code, just for the complexities thereof. And in, as involved as it is, one thing that was, I'll bring this up. We did delete this, but I'll have a little discussion about. Where we're looking at air admittance valves, historically speaking, the uniform plumbing code has never allowed air admittance valves. Air admittance valves, what I mean by that are those Studer vents, those type things, for individual applications or whatever. It's always been not allowed in the uniform plumbing code. International codes have allowed it, but so we have this amendment, and this amendment's been in for several years to allow these. Well, for the first time in the 2012 edition, actually the uniform plumbing code does allow those. As alternate materials and methods of construction, equivalency, or in section 911 of the 2012 UPC, an engineered vent system. So if a designer, engineer, plumbing engineer, and then engineers a plumbing system to include one or more of these air admittance valves, well then yes, the Uniform Plumbing Code does allow that under section 911. So that's the reason that it was removed. And again, these others, it was one, two words different. So very close to the text of the code that it's easier for us to enforce the text of the code than to have amendment.
Jim, the paragraph that you went, just went by 85, the one on the subsoil drains.
Is it 8-85?
Yeah.
Discharge. We had a lot of discussion on this one as well, so we'll spend a few moments. Subsoil drains can be positioned inside or outside the footing. Well, it has been unanimous decision between our subcommittee members and other members of the construction trade that in our area, primary should be inside the footing for these subsoil drains. It also is a great benefit with the radon as well. Now, in the case where installation inside the footing cannot be possible, is not possible, exterior can be approved by the authority having jurisdiction. So the option is still there, inside, outside. Primary, inside. And that was a decision by the subcommittee. Unanimous decision.
It was. But since then, I've talked to designers. I mean, I never was a house designer. But explain to me, and from an engineering standpoint, it makes all kinds of sense. If you've got water coming up, then you've got a head of water out there. So it's both on the outside, on the inside. The outside drainage tile is your first line of defense. The inside is your second line of defense, and it needs to be in both places.
I agree with that.
I think it needs to be in both.
The reason we have, if you only have exterior drain tile, you'll have water up on your slab before it ever starts to drain into the exterior drain tile.
That's true.
It's a really bad idea. McPherson does that, and I've seen water 2 inches up on the slab and then water trickling into the sump pit. So exterior drain tile only is a really bad idea, but interior drain tile only doesn't allow you to catch the water that's coming in beside the foundation and into the sump pit. So it really needs to be both. There's two different ways water can come in, and the interior drain tile catches water coming up from underneath, the exterior drain tile catches water coming down the side, and it really needs to be both.
My whole thing was I thought we needed to make sure that we put it on the inside, because I don't think the outside is enough.
Yeah, that's definitely true.
That's my whole.
Well, then we need to rephrase this.
Right, it needs to be both. But I'd like to see it say that it needs to be inside and out. It's required, inside and out.
Yeah.
In all areas?
In all areas.
Every situation?
I think, yes, definitely.
Well, part of that is, like he was saying, I understand if you have it on the inside and you end up with radon, then they can use that, what, to exhaust the radon. So you just be covering up the bases.
We can fix a radon problem no matter what. The real concern is, let's not get water in houses.
Right.
I think you just raised the price of a house $1,000.
Well, I would rather raise the price than have all my stuff in my basement soaking wet. It'd cost you way more money, because I just had it happen to me this winter.
Yeah, and there are probably some areas where it's a good idea. Did you have drain tile in either place?
No.
So drain tile in either place is probably going to take care of most of the issues.
Exactly.
But it's still, exterior only is still, in my opinion, really bad.
I agree. No, I agree. Exterior, I'd say interior is a necessity.
Right, interior is.
But to have it exterior and interior, I don't agree with interior and exterior.
And that was part of the discussion, because we worded this.
The way we originally wrote it up was it had to be on the inside, and if you wanted to, you could add it to the outside.
Exactly, yeah.
That's the way I think it should read.
Exactly.
And that's the way we'll read.
Yeah.
And there are probably places where it's a really good idea.
Yeah.
Well, I think if you're, say in Salina, if you're within 500 feet of the
dike.
Yeah, dike, you have to put it inside and out, which makes sense. But the normal areas, I don't think you absolutely need it in the interior and the exterior. That's why I think the interior is going to take care of.
Assuming everything is graded properly.
Right, right.
It's probably good most of the time.
Right.
I still think it's one of those things, it's much better if you have a boat.
But the point is, if there's a water table there and you get head pressure, then you need them on both. You need to get rid of that head pressure from whatever water's running as quick as you can. If you're in an area where that isn't going to happen, and I don't know how you determine that, then you probably don't need a boat place.
Yeah.
But like he said, as a homeowner, you have trouble later, then what do you get?
Exactly. Used to, we never put it in years ago. And then they started having problems, had to go back in and put it in, so forth.
Right.
That's major. But then we started putting it in, and it wasn't even required, started putting it in and never had any problem. But as far as, I still don't agree with the inside, outside.
What do you think most home builders do? Inside and outside?
Interior.
Yeah, anymore it's mostly inside.
Inside.
It used to be outside.
Back in the 80s, they only had it outside.
Right.
When they first started putting it in, at least a few outside.
But I mean, I'd say it's interior now.
But the way the code was reading, it was saying you had to put it on the outside, and it didn't.
Our amendment, as it was written originally, it was outside.
Right.
And this is a modification of that to require it inside.
But I think everybody's putting it outside. But everybody's been putting it inside.
So you said it threw out $1,000. Is that really what it costs? Because I thought I had all my drain tile, interior and exterior, and the waterproofing all put in for like somewhere around $1,000.
Well, and you're not changing it that much, because when you put it on the outside, you're going to have to put gravel in there or a sock. And you're going to tie it to the inside. So you got the cost of the pipe, the cost of the sock, or the pipe with the sock.
Right.
The tie-in, the labor, then.
So we're not putting gravel outside of basements now.
You are if you put it in.
If you put it in.
I understand that.
Otherwise, no.
Otherwise, not. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Well, on the outside, there's always extra cost in that. You got to do that for your backfill and everything.
Right.
Get the house and everything. So you can have pretty good labor.
Yeah, I didn't realize we were going to put gravel back filling.
You only do if you put down the drain tile.
Right, right.
And even if you have the sock, they used to use the sock and put no gravel and just backfill, but it just plugs up.
All it does is stop it.
Right.
Yeah.
So you have to backfill, even if you use the sock, you have to backfill with gravel. inside and out.
So is there a requirement to put interior and exterior in within a certain distance of the dike?
I think it's within 500 feet of the dike.
Of the levee.
That's a core requirement.
That's core.
Right.
That's not when you have to build a, basically a bathtub.
Yeah, well, yeah, you have to have.
They've got more requirements so far.
You have to do monolithic pour and everything else.
That is that one. That's the one where you pour the
exterior pump too.
Ten inch slab and all that.
But that's all, I mean, that's the core requires all that.
There's two different requirements for the, from the core, right? There's the one where you pour it like a 10-inch slab that extends out beyond the basement walls and all that stuff. And then there's, and that's within a certain distance. And then another distance out, you can build a basement with a little bit less requirement where you have to put sill sealer down and stuff like that.
Right.
When you.
That's probably from 1,000 to 500 feet. I think that's where the big difference is 1,500 and 500 to.
So between 1,000 and 500, is that, does that require drain tile?
You still have.
Exterior drain tile?
Exterior,
I think so.
Zero to 500, we require an outside with an outside pump, nothing penetrating the floor in the basement.
Okay.
500 to 1,000 would require inside, unless this has changed, it'd require inside drainage and a pump inside.
But no exterior drain tile tied in?
It's not required right now.
Okay.
And it's not required by the core to have both. But the core will not allow you to put it on the inside in the zero to 500 foot range.
Right.
So as it's in there right now, then you're saying that it has to be in the inside, but not inside and out, right? Is that the way I understand it?
Right.
The way you got it.
The way we have it now, shall be positioned inside the footing, period. In the case where installation inside the footing is not possible, if you're within 500 feet of the levee, you cannot put it inside. It's not allowed. You cannot do it.
There's different requirements.
Then it's the authority to have jurisdiction is going to give you special, our permission or our details as mandated by the Corps of Engineers as to that foundation design where that drain tile needs to be. So to leave it as not having an option for exterior, we can't do that. The option for exterior has to exist because of Corps regulations. So that we need to reword any of this the way it's written.
Well, after this.
Because we flipped it from what it was originally, okay?
Right.
As it was written before, it shall be on the outside.
Well, I think a contractor should have the right to, if he wants to put it inside and out, it says here that it would have to be approved by the authority, which I don't know does that wording have to be in there like that? I mean, maybe do they have to be approved, you know, say Daryl says, I'm going to put it inside and out. So he would have to get approval.
We're thinking too, from zero to 500 feet of the levee, the authority having jurisdiction makes that determination on how that one must be installed.
Well, I understand that.
That's
just saying on
requirement.
I'm just saying on a general.
I think if you put it on the inside, you have no problem. I mean, you have to put it in. If you want to put it on the outside, I don't think that's any.
It doesn't prohibit.
Yeah, it doesn't prohibit you to do that. If you want to do it both,
right?
You can do it. It's not going to hurt nothing. It's going to help.
That's what I'm saying.
Right, but I don't think you should be required to do it.
No, I don't think you should be required either. But if you want to put it on,
right.
If you want to put it on the outside, as long as it's nowhere around the levee, I don't think you should have to get approval to do it either.
Right, and I think that anytime you're doing, which I think that would be doing something over. And anytime you do something better, you know, it's not really any problem with that, correct?
True.
That's because most of the stuff is minimum requirements.
It says you don't have to get permission unless you can't do it on the inside.
Right. The inside you have to do in
inside is the shall part of this.
Right. If you want to do it on the outside, that's fine. You don't even need an inspection, basically, to do it.
Well, let's take that sentence out. And that would still leave it at the discretion of the contractor and designer if they want. Of course, zero to 500, it would still that foundation design's already provided for you anyway.
Right, that's a whole different.
It always has been.
Right, right.
Well, the only reason that that's going to go in on the outside now is if the contractor thinks it ought to be there, talks to the owner and says, hey, this is another $1,000.
Right, right. So, I mean, it's not a necessity you don't have to do. So, I mean, that's, I think that's the way it should be.
Such subtotal drain shall be positioned inside the footings, exterior subsoil drains may be allowed, I'll need to work on this one and bring it back. We'll bring back this one section at our next meeting.
I had a question, and maybe it's just an interpretation, on back on section 504.1 in red or 505.1 in black. You're deleting that. And I'm just, is that addressed in the code? I'm concerned.
On which one?
It's back at 504.108-81.2. And then under that, there's a 504.1 and 505.1. There you go, right there. What I'm concerned is with is water heaters in bathrooms in older homes, and I'm just trying to determine exactly what you did do here, if that's
if you take this the way it's written, read it with the red, like it's section 504.1. It used to be section 505.1. That's a given. If you read the rest of this with the red included, that's the exact text of the 2012 Uniform Plumbing Code.
And I thought so. I just wanted to make sure that there was still
absolutely
a possibility of doing that in these older homes.
Is exact text. Basically, they are looking at NFPA 54, as we referenced before, as being the controlling body for anything fuel burning. National Fuel Gas Code. And those references are coming strictly from that text and being implemented into the Uniform Plumbing Code. So they're both saying the same thing.
Okay.
But it's exact the text, the red and the black mixed together. So that's the reason we deleted that. Because other than the NFPA reference, it was reading the same as the code body.
Thank you.
Any other concerns? We're going to go back to this table that we, again, on section 8 dash, what is the new 8-85? Will be 85. It used to be 101. I will bring that back to you in a future meeting or in our next BAB meeting, and I'll have that reworded. And in the interim, you could be emailing me your thoughts on that as well, so we can have it all one consensus as we meet again on that. Everything else in here, I think, is pretty self-sufficient. With the hours that we put in, again, we are deleting code text. We already enforced the code, so that's not an amendment. Here we go back to this table. Nobody knows why this is truly a uniform mechanical code table. This 12-42, why it was plopped into the plumbing code. None of us have a complete knowledge of why it was in the plumbing code as well. Again, like I said, in 2015, it all goes away. It's a moot point. They don't even reference this any longer. They just specific to NFPA 54 is where these numbers are from, and that's what they are going to refer you to, and not have it put into the plumbing code, the mechanical code, and it's a mechanical table anyway. So, everything that you see there, with the exception of when I bring back section one, is actually section 1101.5.1 for discharge, modified to address our concerns for inside and outside foundation drainage. Is it the board's decision to move forward with this as written with that one exception?
So moved.
I second it.
Okay. We have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passed.
A lot of work. It's been quite the experience to get these amendments worked out. Many of them were so antiquated and needed to go away anyway. Suffice it to say, when all is said and done, the new Salina Municipal Code will be a much more streamlined and tree-friendly code. If we go into agenda item G, we also need for this evening the board's directive to continue moving forward with these code adoption process. What we need this evening is to establish and appoint individuals to serve on our next subcommittee, which this time will be the International Fire Code. So we would indeed appreciate a decision on that and to move forward with those appointments that you provide us with this evening. And please say the members' names out loudly so I can record them thusly. I'll turn it over to the chairman.
Any volunteers for the subcommittee?
I'll set in on it.
I'll be in on that one.
I would, but I'm not on.
We're this close.
We're that close, yes.
So what do we have? Chad?
Yes.
Chad, yes? Mark, Mr.
Yes,
Frazier,
sir.
Yes. Who else?
I'll do it.
Cool.
I'll show up if I can. I'm not guarantee I'll be there every meeting, but put my name out so I know when they are, each subcommittee. And I'll try to probably be to a lot of them, but I don't want to.
Now, we will have the fire marshal involved with those as well. Thank you for that. And now we'll discuss, we are a few members shy of having a full board. Mr. Ravenkamp did announce to me that his resignation due to some health issues. And also, Mr. Prester, his last meeting was, of course, last month. his term has expired and he's served two consecutive terms. As such, he's ineligible to serve another term without waiting a year, and then he can reapply. So we are in the process now of looking for two mechanical, one master mechanical, one mechanical contractor, and those are two members we need to focus on and try to fill. I do have one expression of interest form that's been filled out, so our master mechanical may be resolved here in a few weeks, a few days, but still a mechanical contractor we'll need as well. That'll give us a complete board. We still have two youth members that we still haven't filled. And officially, Mr. McCall, taking the place of Mr. Mars, welcome aboard. We're proud to have you, and you should be official by our next meeting. And with that, I don't have anything else. Anything from the chair?
Anybody have any other questions?
I have one thing, and I think you and I talked about this, Jim. The possibility of putting on the agenda of making the hours that are spent by audience participants as whole hours rather than 50%.
Right. If anything that is doing with the code body, the municipal code, residential code, uniform plumbing code, whatever case may be, if it's code specific and it's code related, and we have members in the audience as contractors that are attending those, it will be code credit, yes.
But at present, or the way it's been, they're getting 50% credit if they're
this
here.
This will be a 100% credit.
In other words, you get a half hour credit. I mean,
now,
you used to get a half hour credit for an hour, but now going forward,
if it's code specific to what we're doing here, yes. You'll get full credit for that.
That doesn't take an action on our part.
Right, but say we have something presenting, say I have a presentation that's going to talk about zoning or something next time. Well, then that's a different story at that point. You know, that would be your half credit, whereas not specific to the code body in and of itself, but it's a broad range of topics.
I got a question. Did the lady that was in here with the appeal, did somebody complain? Neighbors complain about her fence?
According to her and what she gave us, the neighbors didn't object to it.
Well, there about has to be in
but
order for the city to be involved.
Someone drove by and saw it, whether they live in the neighborhood or not. So it was brought to our attention. And, of course, we went out to investigate, and we saw that it was quite an athletic dog, I suppose, to increase the fence by another 2 feet.
Like
not unheard of.
Terrier.
I mean, they do strange things sometimes.
Yeah. Okay. If that's all we have, meeting adjourned.